There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living home. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you once again for the privilege to come into your presence. Holy Spirit, as we have just sang, may you be free to move in and through us. Lord, convicting us of sin, calling us to righteousness, and giving us the power to live the life that you've called us to. Father God, we continue to pray for Earl Hughes and Miss Hughes and that family as he struggles with COVID-19. We pray for all, particularly of our senior adults that are separated from their families. This cruel disease has kept families apart for many months now, and I know that's taken a toll on both ends of the equation. Lord, we pray that you'll watch over and protect those in our nursing homes, and thankful for those that work with them. I thought about our college kids today, Lord. So many of them, for the first time, have started college this week, and so we pray for them, Lord. We pray for the things that have been taught to them, and Lord, how they've been grounded in your word will stay with them in the days to come. We know they'll make mistakes. We know that there's a lot of things that they'll be exposed to. But Lord, we pray for your protection over them. And Lord, tonight, as Brother Bob comes in just a moment, we pray that you will empower him to preach your word in a way that as we leave this place tonight, we will be changed for the better because we've had an encounter with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, good evening. It's good to see you here tonight. And let me remind you that just as we're meeting in here, we have a group meeting in our fellowship hall in our mask-only worship service. And since Sunday morning, it's grown by one each night. So, you know, in a year's time, we'll have a bunch of folks in there. So if it keeps up that way, but help us get the word out for those who maybe are a little concerned about coming together in such a big group. But we do have that set up, and that's gone so well. Also, for those that are watching through our Facebook Live and eventually through our YouTube and listening through our Zoom conference call, a special welcome to you. We have tried to make as many ways possible for people to plug in and to be a part of the revival. And it's hard to believe that tomorrow night, the revival services are done, but praise the Lord, revival can really begin. And that's my heart's cry. That's my prayer, is that God will really begin to do a work in us. Brother Bob, thank you for being here. It's such an honor and privilege to have him. I've told you I love him. I don't say that about many men, but I love him. I consider him a friend, a mentor, my former pastor, and so it's always good to have him with us. I pray that you're praying about what God would have you give to our revival love offering. What an honor it is to have the privilege to invest in the ministry of Bob Pittman as he travels all over the state, sometimes all over the world, preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. And as you know as well as I do by now, God has uniquely gifted him to be able to take difficult things and in a very easy to understand way present those that even children can understand them. So at the end of the service, remember we'll have the tithe boxes, and as you leave, just put your love offering in that. So Brother Scott, come. There you are. Come and lead us some more. Thank you.
I appreciate when you said that even children can understand. You didn't look around at me. I appreciate that very much. We're going to have a good time of worship tonight. Let's stand together. We're going to pick it up a little bit. Great hymn, Down at the Cross.
To his name.
I'm the one that planned the order of that song and I forgot it. What a
and
great...
I'm reading what you said to do.
You're doing it right.
Still doing it wrong.
You're doing fine. That's an old song. This is a newer song, but one that's got great words, great message. It's called We Believe.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. To this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. Let the lost be the dead be raised in the here and now, that love in vain, let the church live loud. Our God will say, we believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. We know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe, we believe in God. Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. Coming back, He's coming back again. We believe, we believe.
It's worship, but not these simple words.
I sing praises to your name. Sing praise.
For your name is great and greatly
Well, amen. Wasn't that good? I don't believe Dale Evans and Roy Rogers could have done any better than that. Now, that was mighty, mighty good. Well, you saw the pastor's wife and I leave the service a minute ago. I told her I wanted to go downstairs and speak to those who were down there in the mass group. And I had not been down all week long, and so I had my mask and I put it on when we got out of the door. And I didn't know how to get there, and she did. I thought she did, but when we got downstairs, she led me into a closet. I didn't know where nor was. And so, but she turned around, and we went into the fellowship hall, and we had a great time. But to those of you who are down there, hey again. They wanted me to wave to them, but they were down there, and they were singing. Every one of them was singing when I went down at the cross as you were leading them. But they stopped while I said hi to them, but I didn't stay but a minute because I wanted them to keep worshiping. But thank you for coming. You know, I've been doing this now since 2008. I've been in full-time evangelism for the last 12 years. And I've come to realize that Tuesday night is the lowest attended night of revival. Now, I have no idea why. There must be something in the Bible about that. I don't know. But it is the lowest attended night. But I'm always greatly appreciative of those who come on Tuesday night. And I heard it from the motel where I'm staying. I heard it thunder a little while ago. And that'll take care of 50 Baptists any day. You know, I mean, one thunder, 50 of them will be hiding under the bed. But anyway, thank you for coming. And tomorrow night is our last night. And tomorrow night, if there are more downstairs in the mass room than there are up here, I'm going to go preach down there, and you can watch it on the screen, all right? But you take your Bibles now, please, and turn to Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19, and we're going to begin reading in verse 1. Luke chapter 19, verse 1. If you have found it, say amen. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, for the size of the crowd, because he was little of stature. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured. I tell you, they're always around, that murmuring crowd. And they said that he was gone to be the guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I've taken anything from any man by false accusation, I'll restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation come to this house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which is lost. I know what you're thinking. And I'm not a mind reader, but I know exactly what you're thinking. Every time you read these verses, you think about it. Every time you hear somebody preach from this text or teach from this text, you think about it. And you're thinking about it right now. You learned it when you were a child. Maybe you were in vacation Bible school. Maybe you were in Sunday school. But you've never forgotten it, and you always have it in your heart when you come to this text. And you know what I'm talking about because you're thinking about it. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and he said, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. Remember that? Sure you do. I tell you, that's one of the songs we teach boys and girls in church, and it comes directly from this passage of Scripture. The Bible says Jesus went into Jericho. I've had the privilege of going to the Holy Land 5 times, and the most boring thing in the world to me is to go see somebody showing slides of going to the Holy Land, so I'm not going to do that. But I do want to tell you that Jericho is a real place, and if you ever go to the Holy Land, you'll go to Jericho because it's one of the most highly visited places there, and it is an oasis. I'm telling you, it is an oasis in a vast desert. It really is an oasis in the midst of a great, vast, arid desert. Here you have the city of Jericho, and there are trees, and there are vegetables growing, and there are fruits of all kind. If you ever go there, you'll want to get one of those pomelos that's a cross between a grapefruit and an orange, and it's about that big, and you peel it off, and oh my soul, it is so good. And so Jesus goes into Jericho. And by this time, everybody's talking about him. Everybody wants to see him. And so the crowd begins to gather. There's only one main street that goes down through Jericho as far as parades are concerned. And so everybody wanted to see him, so they lined the street. Well, in the city of Jericho, there was a man by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a short man. He was, I don't know if he was a midget or not, but he was little of stature. And the Bible said he was chief among the publicans. Now, that's not republican, that's publicans. Those are tax collectors. He was the chief among the tax collectors, and everybody hated him. And the Bible says he was rich. And the reason he was rich, because he was a crook. You see, all the publicans were crooks. You see, the publicans were hired by the Roman government to collect the taxes. The Roman government imposed taxes on everybody. And the way that these publicans made their living was by overcharging the people more than what the Roman government had required them to levy upon the people. And so that's how they made their money. The Roman government said, get $50 from this guy. Well, the publicans would take $75 from that guy. And they would pocket the $25 over what the Roman government had said to get. And so the Bible says that Zacchaeus was the chief publican. That means he was over that whole corrupt system. And the Bible says he was rich. That means he had been taking from everybody. I mean, everybody knew who he was. Everybody knew what kind of a man he was. And everybody knew that he was a crook, and everybody hated him. But he wanted to see Jesus. Even wicked people have curiosity. And so he goes down to where Jesus is going to be passing down the street. But there's so many people there, he cannot possibly get up and be able to see him. And maybe he didn't want anybody to see him. I mean, if he gets in a big crowd, somebody might put a shield in his side. You never know. And so he climbs up a sycamore tree. And he's sitting in the tree as Jesus passes by. And that's the setting for this passage of Scripture. Now, this text is not about the disadvantages of being short, okay? That's not what this is about. And this text is not a treatise on sycamore trees. And this text is not about how to creatively watch a parade. That's not about what this is about at all. This text is about salvation. We use the word salvation, we use the word saved in our churches all the time. I mean, it is one of the most frequently used words in church, and rightly so. It is a wonderful word, and it expresses a wonderful truth. We sing about it, we teach about it, we preach about it, we talk about it. It's one of the most important words, and yet many people who talk about salvation really don't have a clear understanding about what it really is. A lot of folks think, well, I walked down an aisle, therefore I'm saved. I prayed a prayer, therefore I'm saved. I joined the church, therefore I'm saved. But all of those things are good, but none of those things are salvation. We find the definition of salvation here in verse 5. In verse 5, Jesus extends salvation to Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was up a tree. The Bible said Jesus looked up and he saw him. And not only did Jesus see him, Jesus knew him. Jesus called him by name. Zacchaeus, Now, they'd never been introduced. Zacchaeus had never seen Jesus, but Jesus knew who he was. And I want to tell you tonight, he knows who you are too. He knows more about you than you know about yourself. And so he saw Zacchaeus and he knew Zacchaeus and he wanted Zacchaeus. He said, I want you to come down. For today, I must abide at your house. And that's what salvation is. The word abide means to come inside and to remain forever. It means to stay. It means to continue on and on and on. Jesus said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Your heart is not a hotel room. He does not check in and then check out later. When Jesus comes in, he comes in to stay, to abide, to remain forever and ever. And that's what salvation is. Salvation is that time when Jesus on the outside comes to live on the inside of you. And you can join a church. You can be baptized enough times to be on speaking terms with catfish. You can walk enough aisles to wear out carpet. But I'm telling you, you will never be saved until Jesus Christ comes to live inside of you. And when that happens, you know it. Hear me? When that happens, you know it. You don't ever have to wonder, am I saved or not? If Jesus is on the inside, he does not come in to play hide and seek. He comes in to take control. If he lives in your heart, you know he's in your life. One lady said, well, I don't know if he's in my life or not. Now, wait a minute, hon. Jesus is the Son of God. He's the one who created the world. He's the one who died upon the cross. He's the one who rose from the dead. He's the one who ascended into heaven. He's the one who sits at the right hand of the majesty on high. He's the one that one day is coming back again. You mean he can be in your life and you not even know he's there? No. You see, that's what salvation is. And Jesus is extending the invitation to Zacchaeus, who's up in the tree. He says, make haste and come down, because today I want to come and abide to live in you forever and forever and forever. And that's what salvation is. And Jesus not only gives the definition of salvation as he extends this invitation to Zacchaeus, he also gives the condition for salvation. Jesus said, come down. If you're going to be saved, you're going to have to come to Christ. He didn't say come to a theological position. He didn't say come to a denomination. He didn't even say come to a local church. He said, come to me. The Bible says, come to Jesus. If you'll just come to him. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Those who come to him, he no way will refuse to let them come. He has an open invitation. And so, what does it mean to be saved? It means that Jesus comes to take up permanent residence in your heart. And in order for that to happen, we must come to him. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. And that's what the Old Testament prophet Isaiah wrote in chapter 1 of his book. Come, come, come. We come to Christ for salvation. So we see the definition, we see the condition, we come to him, but also notice the urgency. He says, make haste and come down. Make haste. I live in Alabama, and in Alabama, make haste means hurry up. Hurry up. You see, there's an urgency about salvation. You know what some people believe? Some people believe they can be saved just anytime they get ready. Preacher, I know I need to be saved, and preacher, one day I plan to be saved, but preacher, I'm just not ready. Man, there are things I want to do, there are places I want to go, there are people I want to see, I've got wild oats I have to sow, and when I get all of that done, when I've done all the exciting things in the world, and I'm old and worn out and can't do any better, then I think I'll probably get saved. Hey, it doesn't work like that, friend. You can't be saved just any time you get ready to be saved. You can only be saved while God is ready to save you. And he will pass by, but he may keep on going. You see, that's what the Bible said here. Jesus is passing by. And he never went back to Jericho again. He never did. This was the last time. He passed by and he never went back. If Zacchaeus had not been saved on that time, at that time, he would have never been saved at all. You see, you may die. You may sit in a service like this and the Holy Spirit of God deal with your life, and you know that you're lost and you know you need to be saved, and the Holy Spirit will be speaking to your heart and drawing you to Christ, but you say no, and as fast as you can get out of the church, you run out the door and you say, "Phew, I made it tonight. They didn't get me tonight." But you see, you can be killed on the way home. And when a person dies, they never, never again have an opportunity to be saved. Or you could lose your mind. I mean, something could happen. You could be involved in an automobile accident, and you're not necessarily killed, but your brain becomes damaged and you no longer have the ability to call upon the Lord. You don't have to be a brain surgeon in order to be saved. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to be saved, but you do have to have enough mental power to know that you are a sinner and that Jesus is the Savior, and you must call upon Him to be saved. And so you can die, you can lose your mind, or Jesus may just pass by and never speak to you again. And so Jesus said, "Zacchaeus, make haste. Hurry up. Don't put it off. Come down right now. Today, today, I want to abide with you." The Bible says today is the day of salvation. The Bible never one time says be saved tomorrow. As a matter of fact, the writer of Proverbs said, don't boast about tomorrow, because tomorrow may not ever come. In those old greenback Broadman hymnals Baptists used to sing out of 100 years ago, there was an invitation song called, "Oh, Why Not Tonight?" You couldn't sing it on Sunday morning because it wouldn't make any sense. But we would sing it at night, "Oh, Why Not Tonight?" And verse 2 said this, "Tomorrow's sun may never rise to bless your long deluded sight. This is the time, oh, then be wise, be saved, oh, tonight." And so in verse 5, we see salvation extended. Now, in verse 6, we see salvation experienced. Did Zacchaeus get saved? Well, he sure did. Look what verse 6 says. "And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully." First of all, Zacchaeus heard the word. Jesus said, "Make haste and come down." And the Bible said he made haste and came down. You see, he heard what Jesus said. There was no question about it. There was no, in his mind, there was not any consequences other than the fact that he had heard the word of the Lord. But not only did he hear the word, that's the first step in becoming a Christian, he obeyed the word. Jesus said, "Make haste and come down." And the Bible says he made haste and came down. If you're going to be a Christian, you're going to have to obey the word of God. And Paul wrote to the church at Thessalonica in 2 Thessalonians, and he said to those people that many around you are lost because they do not know God and they have not obeyed the gospel. And so if you're going to be a Christian, you must hear the word. How shall they hear without a preacher? How shall they hear without a witness? They have to hear the word of God, and then they have to obey the word of God, and then they have to receive Jesus into their life. The Bible says in verse 6, "And he received him joyfully." And you know, I've been preaching now for 56 years. And that's a lot of preaching. That's a lot of sermons. That's a lot of Baptists. And I'm just telling you, I don't know of any other way you can receive Jesus than joyfully. I don't know how you can receive Jesus angrily. I tell you, I'm as mad as the devil, but I'm going to let Jesus come in. But no, no, you can't receive Jesus angrily. You can't receive Jesus bitterly. I tell you, that person in that church that sits two rows in front of me, they said something about me and made me so mad, and I hate them with all of my heart. I can't stand them, and I'm going to get back at them, but I'm going to receive Jesus, right? No, you don't receive Jesus bitterly. You don't receive Him angrily. The only way you receive Him is joyfully. I'm a sinner. I'm lost. I'm on my way to hell. But Jesus came. He took all of my sin upon himself. He carried it to the cross and died, gave his life for me. And he rose from the dead that I might have everlasting life. Praise God. Jesus, with joy, I receive you into my life. And so I see salvation extended in verse 5. And I see salvation experienced in verse 6, he heard the word, he obeyed the word, and he received Jesus joyfully. Hey, have you ever done that? Have you ever done that? I don't mean have you ever walked down an aisle and filled out a card and got baptized, joined the church? Have you ever heard the word of God and obeyed the word of God and received Jesus joyfully? When you do that, you know what happens? He comes in and he abides with you forever and forever. And so I see salvation extended. I see salvation experienced. But now also in these verses, I see salvation expressed. What difference does it make when Jesus comes into a person's life? When I got saved, am I going to think the same old thoughts? Am I going to go to the same old places? Am I going to do the same old things? No. But the Bible says if any man be in Christ, he is a what? A new creature. I'm not the same person I used to be. Jesus made me a brand new person. Well, how do we express our Christianity? Well, look what he says there in verse 8. And Zacchaeus stood. Boy, I like that. I tell you, we live in a day where we need more of God's people to take a stand, don't they? We need some folks that'll just be steadfast in their faith in the Lord Jesus. Zacchaeus, now here were all these murmurers, that crowd. They were murmuring. They said, oh, that man Jesus, he's gone to be in the house of a man who is a sinner. And they were right. And thank God they were right. I was in a revival years ago, and the fellow leading the singing sang a hymn, and the title of the hymn was, Jesus, what a friend for sinners. And the lady came to the end of the service, and after we were dismissed, a lady came to me. She was a great big old lady. She had glasses on her stick, and she kind of waddled up to me, and she said, preacher, I wish you would talk to that singer about those songs we've been singing. I said, well, ma'am, what song are you talking about? She said, well, that song, Jesus, what a friend of sinners. I know that cannot be true. I said, ma'am, it is true, and you better be glad it's true, because if Jesus wasn't a friend of sinners, he never would come to your house. You're the biggest sinner I've seen in Hartsville, Alabama. That's where that revival was taking place. I'm telling you, Jesus is the best friend sinners have ever had. Thank God he spends time with sinners. Thank God he loves sinners. Thank God he died for sinners. Thank God he came to seek and to save, not the righteous, but those who were lost in their sin. Zacchaeus stood. We live in a day when not many people stand. And hey, if you don't stand for something, you will fall for anything. He stood. One of the ways we express our genuineness of our salvation, one of the ways we let folks know that we're really saved, is that we stand on the Word of God. We stand on the moral character of God. We stand. We are steadfast in our faith. But notice the second thing. Not only do we express our salvation when we are steadfast, we express our salvation through our, I hate to bring this up, but it's here, our generosity. Look what it says. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of all my goods I give to the poor. I don't think I have ever really known a stingy Christian. A person who has received so much from God cannot help but want to be a generous person. When I was a little boy, my first cousin, she's a few years older than me, well, several years older than me, but when I was a little boy, she gave birth to her first baby. And all of the family went over to the house where she lived, and everybody wanted to see that little baby. You know, we always want to talk about how long the baby was and how much the baby weighed and all that. You ask a grown lady how much she weighs and see what a joyful response you get from that. But we all want to know about how much little babies weigh, and so we all were there. And I was just sitting. I'm an only child. My wife says it shows. So I didn't have any big brothers or big sisters or little brothers or sisters, and I'd not been around babies. And so I got a chair and I sat across that little crib where that brand new baby was born. And back in that day when I was a boy, babies slept on their stomach. Now they sleep on their back. In a few years they'll have them sleeping standing up. But when I was a boy, babies slept on their tummy. And my grandmother, my big mama that I called her, my grandmother, she was an old-time godly Presbyterian woman. I would be sitting there watching that little baby asleep, and that little baby would have its hands kind of folded up like that. And my grandmother would walk by, she reached over, and she took that little baby's hands and spread the fingers out like that. And she went on. And a little while later, that little baby would roll those fingers back up. And my grandmother would come back by and look in the crib, and she would reach down and spread those fingers out. And she did that about 5 or 6 times. And I said, "Big Mama, why are you doing that?" And she said, "Well, I've always been told if you let a little baby sleep with his hands rolled up like that, it'll grow up to be stingy. And I don't want any of my children or grandchildren or great-grandchildren to grow up to be stingy." And I don't know where my grandmother got that. That was probably some old wives' tale, and she may have been the old wife that started it. I don't know. But you see, it impressed me, and as a little boy, I've never forgotten that my grandmother said, "I don't want any of my children or grandchildren or great-grandchildren to grow up to be selfish or stingy." And I tell you, folks, one of the signs of a Christian salvation, one of the evidences that you've been born again, is God will give you a generous heart. It's not ours anyway. It all belongs to Him. Everything. John D. Rockefeller died. He was the richest man in the world when he died. Now, there's some that got more money than he had now. But when John D. Rockefeller died, he was the richest man in the world. And he was laying in an open casket, and people were coming by viewing his body. And two very successful businessmen, they were wealthy, but they were not as wealthy as John D. Rockefeller. When those two men came down and were viewing his dead body in the casket, one of them said to the other, "I wonder how much old John left behind." And the other man said, "All of it. All of it." You'll never see a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer, amen? You don't carry that stuff with you. You leave it all behind. And thank God for the privilege of being a generous person. And by nature, most of us are not like that. By nature, most of us are kind of selfish. By nature, we want to take care of number one. But when we become Christians, we're no longer number one. Jesus is number one. And He allows us to have things so that we can share them with others. And so one of the evidences of salvation is that we take a stand, we're steadfast, and another evidence of salvation is that we have a spirit of generosity. But thirdly, we have a spirit of restitution. Look what he says there at the end of verse 8. He says, "And if I've taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold." Hey, he had taken by false accusation. He was a publican. He had overcharged people. He had taken money that they did not owe and put it in his pocket. But you see, when God saves a person, that person wants to try to make things right with those they have wronged before. Now, sometimes you can't do it. There are some people that maybe they've died, maybe they've moved so far away you don't know where they are. And then there are some people who are so bitter they won't accept anything you have to say. But I'm telling you, one of the evidences of salvation is God puts in your heart a desire to make things right with people you wronged before you got saved. And so I see salvation extended to Zacchaeus. I see salvation experienced by Zacchaeus, and I see salvation expressed by Zacchaeus. He took a stand, he was generous in his spirit, and he wanted to make things right with those he had wronged. Have you ever been saved? Have you ever been saved? How are you expressing your salvation? If you were arrested tomorrow and put on trial and you had to prove that you were a Christian, what evidence would you bring? These are not the only three expressions of salvation, but these are three biggies. These are three important ones. It's good to be saved. The most wonderful thing in this world is to be saved. And the second most wonderful thing in this world is to know that you're saved. And the third most wonderful thing in this world is to let others know that you've been saved. How is it with you? Are you saved tonight? Are you allowing others to see the change in your life that Jesus has made? An old hymn. I tell you, I haven't heard it in 50 years. Really. An old song we used to sing, but I never hear it anymore. While passing through this world below, and others your life may view. Where you go, whatever you do, let others see Jesus in you. Do folks see Him in you? They should, if He's living inside. I mean, if He's there, He's there to stay. And He's always manifest His presence through those that belong to Him. Well, if you're not saved, why don't you get saved tonight? You say, Brother Bob, there's not many folks here. That's okay. There might be one here that's never been saved. And do you know that God never made a better night than August the 18th in which to be saved? I mean, there's not a better night in the whole calendar to get saved than August the 18th. I promise you. It's the best night I know of to get saved. And that's tonight. Are you expressing that Christian faith? Do others see in you the reality of Christ? If not, why don't you just make your way to this altar tonight? Why don't you just come to this altar and just say, Lord, I know you're saved. I know that I'm saved. I know you saved me. But I'm not sure I've been expressing that like I should. But tonight, I want revival. I want revival in my life. I don't know how much time I have left, but whatever time I have left, I really do want others to see Jesus in me. Father, Lord, I've done my very best to take this really very familiar passage of Scripture and look at it perhaps from a little different perspective. And Lord, I thank you that Zacchaeus was saved, and I thank you that he expressed his salvation so vividly. Lord, I pray that I'm expressing mine as real as he did. And Lord, if there's anybody here tonight who's never been saved, don't let them leave without Christ. Lord, speak to them, touch them, draw them to yourself. And Lord, if there are Christians who need to start fresh, they just need to begin again in their walk with you, I pray they'd come to this altar and just make some things right with you. And we'll give you the praise for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen. We stand together, we sing our hymn of invitation. As we sing, will you come right now while we wait? Come on, right now.
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Oh, don't you let him come in.
Let him come in. Let him come in.
There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer? To see if you're willing to open.
Thank you, Brother Bob. Another clear word from the Word. Never quite heard the story Zacchaeus put in that way. Let me encourage you about something. You know what? The invitation is not over. We're through tonight. We're getting ready to leave. But you know what? I've seen the Lord work this way in people's lives. In the wee hours of the morning, you may be lying there in the bed thinking, "Oh, I wished I'd gone forward. I wished I'd made a decision for Christ." Listen, call me. Just call me on my cell phone. It's always right by my bed. Now, I prefer you wait to at least 6 a.m., but if it's 2 a.m., I'll take the call. Or come see me. Don't let Jesus pass you by. You'll regret it for all eternity. Well, thank you for being here. Remember, tonight, one more night, 6:30. We'll have all the Facebook Live and mask-only worship going on in our fellowship hall. And let our folks know, hey, we're having revival services. Grab and bring somebody with you. Beth and I have been trying to think and talk about who we can get and invite to revival. And let me encourage you to do the same. And remember, as you leave tonight, we have our tithe boxes. You have an opportunity to invest in the ministry of Brother Bob. And let me just encourage that you give generously to his ministry. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and we'll be dismissed. Father God, as we leave this place, we thank you that we can know for sure that you're our Savior, that we're saved for all eternity. And Lord, even more importantly than that, Lord, we can know for sure that you have a plan for our lives, that when we walk out these doors, we're surrounded by a community that's lost, and you've given us the wonderful blessing, the wonderful privilege of being the ones to carry the gospel to break the darkness. Give us a heart to do that. As a church, Lord, we pray that you'll give us a heart to do that. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Good night, everyone. See you tomorrow night.